Oh, we're recording. Good morning. Welcome to Suffolk Socks, where I let's knit podcast. My name's Julie Walters, and you can find me on all social media as Suffolk Socks. I have Instagram, Facebook, and Ravelry. I'm more active on Instagram, and I'm absolutely hopeless on Facebook. Ravelry, I seem to have got out of touch with Ravelry a little bit at the minute. But we do have a Ravelry group. So, good morning. It's Wednesday, the 27th of April. And I know that because I've got it written down. I'm podcasting early this morning. We've been staying at our caravan. We have a caravan not far from here. And we had to come back for a meeting at 12 o'clock. So, John's working in the bedroom on a conference call. And I thought, do you know what? I'm going to do a podcast today because I've got all my knitting in one place. Well, some of you knitting. So, right. Sorry about the lighting. I'm facing this way because in that corner is a pile of my ironing that I've got to do. That just gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And in this corner, there's Vera. Vera, there she's there, sitting on a basket, being a guard dog, watching the world go by. And there's my sock machine. So, right. So, I've got a few finished objects to show you today. Not too much. Well, actually, I have got quite a few. Because it's been so long since I podcast that I thought, right, I'll just show you everything. So my first finished object is my, let's start with socks first. I am a sock shop, so I suppose I should say that, shouldn't I? I own Suffolk Socks, which is a small online yarn shop, independently run just by me, and I have a fabulous assortment of commercial sock yarn. And I have a few lines of hand-dyed yarn. I've got Life in the Long Grass. And I was going to say Fibre Space, but Fibre Space is more or less a commercial yarn these days. But I have got some Life in the Long Grass. I've also got a section that has baby wool in. And a section of embroidery and needlework, but I am going to phase that out over the next few weeks. Just things are in the pipeline and I need to reduce the quantity of stock I've got. So right, so my first finished objects. I keep calling it in dark, I don't know why that is. My first finished objects are man socks. I love these. These are using Regia Yak wool. And I love them. It's got such a lovely heathery halo. Let's see if I can get it up close. So yeah, so just a plain vanilla sock, my favourite sock. 72 cast on, 2.25mm needles, a 1x1 rib, a long leg. I wanted to make these as long as possible. Heel flap with a slip stitch and garter tab that I normally do. And a star toe. And I reckon I didn't have very much left out of the wool because I wanted to make them as long as possible. So I was a bit concerned that we'd have to have the toes different, but no, I managed to get a full size 12 sock out of these and an extra long leg. My next sock I finished is one of my designs and they are my caravan socks. Now, I had these made up as a kit when I did the East Anglian Yarn Festival, and they sold so well. They're made up of using John Arbon Exmoor sock wool and so you have a solid colour and a set of minis. And that's my design that you can find over in my shop. This is a range that I am going to phase out. So once all the wool's gone, I won't be restocking it. But yeah, these are mine. Well, I'm saying they were made for my feet. I haven't got around to wearing them yet, or if I'll ever get around to wearing them. They're just a good sample for in the shop. So yeah, that's those. And another pair I finished, or again, just vanilla socks, using opal wool this time, and they're a woman's size. And I just say that, they are just, you know, universal, non-gender. Just, I class my man socks are 72 cast on, and my women socks are 60 or 64 sock cast on. So the women means it's for all the women in my family, and the men means it's for all the men in my family. So these are for a woman in my family, I don't know who. But so yeah, one by one. I've knit them a bit longer. And heel flap and star toe. I usually do a fish lips kiss heel, and I do one of my signature twist cast-ons. But I've got back into doing rib. Another thing I've got back into is DPNs, the wooden ones. Only because when I was at East Anglian Yarn Fair again, somebody wanted to see how they work, so I just opened a packet and used them. And I thought myself, oh, and I can knit much faster on DPNs than I can Magic Loop. I've cast these off, and I haven't cast them back on again. Actually, I don't even know where my DPNs are, because when I was at the caravan, my husband used my good Knit Pro needles to get the radio out of our mini. So he said he hasn't snapped them, so I think he's put them in one of my knitting bags, but who knows where. So my next finished object is a blanket I've been making. Now I stock, oh look, there I go again, getting dark. I stock West Yorkshire Spinners Bo Peep Baby Wool. And I love seeing all these blankets on Instagram. And I can do a granny, you know, I can crochet, but it's not my favourite. But I've made all my two eldest grandchildren crochet blankets. So I thought I better make me third grandchild crochet blanket. But I didn't want to make her one for when she was born, because Phoebe, my youngest, knit her a baby blanket. So I've crocheted her one for her first blanket, just to say she's got a crochet blanket from grandma like the other two. And let's see if I can find the right size. And this is it. Nothing fancy. It's in the DK weight wool, so it is slightly heavier, but it's heavier than a style craft, that's for sure. Because the other one, and I think the other baby blankets I made was in Snuggly Baby. And that's lovely for it. It's just all acrylic, but it's nice. So yeah, so this is it. So I did 9 granny squares. And, you know, this is not a chosen design. It was like, I'm sick of these now. So I joined them all together and I just went for a great big granny square. Going round and round and round and round and round. And then I did a scalloped, or whatever you call it, scalloped shell pattern edging. So there you go. That's our Daisy's blanket. They're lovely colours. I went for all the vintagey colours. And the only one I wish I hadn't put in is that pink, because it's a bit wishy-washy. It looked nice at the time, but I wish I'd added more of the darker pink. But there you go. She liked it. And Lydia liked it. My daughter was very knit-worthy. What else have I got? Right, one more thing that I finished, which is a cowl. Now I have a love-hate relationship with fluff, and this is using some Surrey silk alpaca, and this is the Cooma cowl by Laura de Bratz. Now, Jackie, my friend, was knitting this when I was at her house. Let's see if I can get rid of that so you can see. Oh, there. So there you go. This is lovely. It was a nice knit. And it looks lovely. My only complaint about this is, my personal complaint is that I used a set of minis from the Knitting Shed, Louise and Nicola. And they were beautiful. I love the Knitting Shed. If I go to Vera, oh, just give us a minute. Vera, no. It's a bus. Come and sit with me. It's a bus. Right, there, just sit here. Who's that? Look. Say hello. So when I go to a yarn festival, I always buy from them. That's my treat. And I bought one of their set of minis, and they were beautiful. But when I've added the Surrey silk, they've just like taken every bit of colour out of it, really. I wish I'd used a set of scraps, leftovers, to be honest, because I had these earmarked for some socks. And I don't think the fluff does the colour justice for the hand-dyed wool, because it was beautiful on its own. And I think I've spoiled it putting the fluff to it. Even though it's pretty as it is, I wish I'd just left it. I know Jackie, she's just paired her mohair up the same, you know, like for like, colour-wise. But I don't have a lot of mohair. Well, I don't have any. I just had a skein of that. And so, yeah, but never mind. I learnt my lesson. I'll just have to rebuy some minis when I next see them. So there you go. That's that one. And there were my finished objects. We're now into whips. And my sock mojo went a little bit. I don't know what happened, but I wasn't having any of it. I wasn't very well. Well, I'm fine. Anyway, right. So my sock mojo went. And I never really got it back. Even when I went to a knitting retreat in Melmaby with a yarn story and met her, so Carmen and met her, I thought, oh, I'll take some socks. I went to stay with Emma beforehand. And I wasn't really feeling it, which has surprised me because I absolutely adore knitting socks. So I took my jumper with me and I knit on that. So it's living in my pink hazel bag. And this is my own pattern. God knows what it's going to turn out like, but so far I like it. So I might even try it on, show you actually. So this is it. I just cast on at the neck and went for it. Let's see. Now it's going to be a bit of a, it is a crop top. So I'll try it on. I never model when I do it. Well, that's usually because I've got socks and I kind of bend my legs up that far. So I'm on the last sleeve. So I have lost a little bit of weight, not a lot, but so I've got, oh, right, here I am. I've got 3/4 length sleeves and it's cropped. It needs to be blocked out, but it's a bit big there for us. So, sorry about the lighting. So, oh God, that's getting on my nerves now. I don't even know why it's doing it. Let's see if I can get it like that. Right, so I'm using Spindrift and Jameson's. I can never get which one's which. And this pattern is what I added. I've got a sock design, a colourwork sock design. So I just took that pattern and what have you. I've blocked the body, but not the colour work. So once it's all blocked, it'll look okay. But I quite like it. And I love Spindrift. I do. I'm saying that. I love Spindrift, but I'm not knitting it in Spindrift. I'm knitting it in Jameson's because I bought it in a cowl. Now, the reason I'm using this is madness. When we moved to this apartment, I bought one of those beds with the flip-up mattresses, and which is a bloody ton weight to lift up. So, you know, that's no good for me because I'm not strong enough to keep it up and get... Anyway, to keep me wool in, right? I bought a new bed just to keep me wool starching because I didn't have enough storage here. And I had a great big corn. Could I heck get that to lie flat so that the bed went down? So method in my madness was... I'll just cast on and knit it. And so I have. Anyway, that's it. So I really like it. I think it's going to be a good jumper in my wardrobe because I've got another jumper in Spindrift. It's yellow and grey and it was on the front page of Shell and Wool Week. I wear that all the time. All the time. So yeah, so hopefully I'll get that finished. And that's what I knit when I was at the retreat. And I've been knitting another jumper for Jonathan, but I've left that at my caravan, so I can't show it to you. But then this past few weeks, my sock knitting's come back. So I cast on a couple of pairs of socks. And again, they're nine socks. So I'll just show them to you, shall I? And actually, I've really loved knitting on these. But I'm knitting using Steels, I think. Yeah, they're steels. I was using higher sharps. They are lethal, aren't they? They should come with a health hazard one. They've got the end of my finger. I don't even know if you can see it. So I've knit one. Again, I've gone big. And I was at a knitting group on Monday night, a lovely knitting group, lovely group of ladies. I've just been twice at the Wool Barn Felixstowe, because my van's in Felixstowe. And some of the people I knew just from, you know, days gone by. But Christy was there, who is, CSK? I can't remember what her Instagram account is, but she's a fabulous knitter. Now, Christy has an Etsy shop, if you want to pop over and have a look. And she's a hardcore sock and shawl knitter. And some of the socks that she's knit, she sells on her Etsy shop. I think it is an Etsy shop. So you want to pop over because, you know, I think from what I can remember, so don't quote me on this, they are a good price. A very good price, actually, considering how much work she's put into them. But I do know she sells them. And anyway, I was saying to her, I think I'm going to be playing yarn chicken with these. And she was like, no, I don't think you will. Don't think you will. So that, you know, all the concerns went out my mind. Because if Christy says, I'm not. Even though I know I'm not. But just to have her reassure us that was quite good. So anyway, so this is an opal wool. I love opal. That's this one, and this is the other one I've knit this one. So I've really been hard at it, knitting me socks. And they live in my Hoey socks bag, which, actually, shameless self-promotion, I do have a few left in the shop. So that's them. Right. Let's talk sock tube army. Oh my God, that sock machine. Now, anybody who says, and I'm not casting or insinuating, you know, I'm just saying, anybody who says that they picked up their sock machine and they just rattled a tube off while they're lying through their front teeth, I hope. Because I picked up my sock machine and I wanted to put it through the window. I was like, my God. So then I was talking to my friend Julia, who has a sock machine called Cynthia. And she could sympathise with me. It's like, anyway, I couldn't get it right. So in the end, I emailed Earl Backer, where I got it from, and spoke to a lovely person called Kim. And they asked me to send some photographs of all different stages. So I did. And they got back to me and said, I know exactly what's wrong. I'm going to send you a photograph of where your tension should be at and what it should look like. And do you know what? That person was right. So I just changed all my attention to where it was on their photograph. And, it's just changed my life. Not for the fact I'm knitting loads of sock tubes, just for the fact I'm not stressing around. I've spent that much money on a sock machine. I can't do it. Now, it's early. You know, I don't want to do the marathon before I can do, like, just the, you know, the start. But I don't think there'll be any heels, toes and cuffs anytime soon. But I have got some tubes. And it's my friend's husband, Julie's husband, said she was rattling these tubes off and he said, I can't believe you've spent that much money on a bloody sock machine and you've still got a winder handle. I'm with them. Right, so these are my sock tubes. Aren't they lovely? There's a few faults. There's a few faults in them. Not many. Because obviously if I drop a stitch, I haven't figured out how to pull it back up yet. Well, I can. But it's a case of does it get worse before it gets better? Not in my case. It's easier just to cast off and start again. And these sock tubes are going to be for a knitting retreat I'm doing. I'm doing a knitting retreat in October the 10th. There is one place left, one room left. And I'm doing it on my own this time. Because Emma usually does it with me, but I'm doing it on my own this time. So I'm slightly more organised about what we're going to be doing. Not because I'm not organised when Emma's there, but it's just usually Emma does a class and what have you. So I really push that at the back of my mind and think, oh, that's one thing I don't have to think about. So, we're going to be doing a class on, well, not so much a class, but we're just going to be all sitting around a table and working on an afterthought heel. And but I have got a few things, but I can't tell you because it's a secret. Well, it's not a secret, it's just a surprise for the retreat. So yeah, so I am going to have a section in my shop called Sock Tube Army and see how that goes. I mean, I love sock tubes. I do love sock tubes, but then I love knitting my socks. So it's a real dilemma for me. I don't know if anybody else has this dilemma because I love spinning. I love my spinning wheel. And I love my sock machine and I love my hand knitting, but then I love sewing as well. So I have a tendency that if I'm doing my sock machine, I'm thinking, oh, I should be knitting. And then if I'm doing my spinning, I'm like thinking, oh, I really should be doing my knitting on my sock machine. Then if I'm doing my sewing, I'm thinking, well, I should be doing my knitting. Then if I'm doing my knitting, I'm thinking, oh, I should really be getting that dress made that I've got the material for. And, oh, I should be making bags and stuff. And in the end, I'm so flustered and stressed out that I think, out of pot with it, I'm going to get my book and just sit and read. Does anybody else have that? The other thing I want to ask, and this is madness, right? When I'm knitting a sock, now, it doesn't matter. So I'll get my socker finished, right? So, right, you've knit your sock, you've got your sock in, right? Then you cast on, and you've knit about an inch. I actually hold it up to my sock to say, oh, am I nearly there yet? Even though my brain's tense, don't be ridiculous, I've got about another 6 inches to go. Like this here, I've done the heel flap. Now, I've already measured it up to see how far I've knit from there. And I've just picked up. And I'm thinking, well, and I know what once I get to there, I'll probably measure up again. And I'm like, that's absolutely ridiculous. But I can't get out of the habit of it. And every time I do it, I laugh and think, that's absolutely mad. But there. So anyway, that's all I've got to show. I'm trying to think, what have we done? It's been so long since I did a podcast and I showed my face because I'm a bit out of my comfort zone doing this. So I have to think about it for a few weeks and I do one. And then I'm so stressed out about putting it out on the web or whatever you call it that it's so out of date and I don't bother. But what have I done? Right. I've been in hospital. I went in for a day op. I had lots of lovely messages. So thank you for that. I'm absolutely fine. So that's full stop at that one. There's no more. Yeah, that's fine. Then, I went up north. That was in February. I went up north. Oh, I had the best time ever. Honestly, I had to be dragged back to Ipswich screaming and shouting. I could have moved back in a shot. If I could just move all my kids up there, I would move up. I moved up, absolutely loved it. I loved spending the time with my sister-in-law. And of course, my mum and dad still live up there. So I loved seeing them. It was a bit of a shame because my mum got COVID. My dad got COVID first, so we'll put off our visit going up. And then on the drive, we went up a day early from what we told everybody because John was going to be on a conference call for a while. So rather than we go up and people phoned up saying when I was going and me nagging them to say I want to go up. I went up knowing I wouldn't see anybody for a day. But on the way up, I got a phone call for saying my mum had tested positive for COVID. So I saw her for about 4 days from the bottom of her drive. Then on the fifth day, she was clear. So and she checked and everything. So I saw her for a bit. And what have you. But so that was a shame. But my sister-in-law, my sister and knitters, so we went for a trip to Ring of Rosie, which is never disappointing. I love Ring of Rosie in Whitley Bay. It's lovely. So I did that, then we came back and I screamed and shouted all the way home that I wanted to move back up north, even though I knew there was, like, you know, no chance of me moving back up north. I'm firmly established now down here. And we did that. Then last week we went over to see our friends who Jonathan went to school with Michael from being about 10, 11 and we're each other's children's godparents. So Michael's like a non-blood family, really. So we went to see them. We had a lovely time. They live like in a little hamlet surrounded by countryside. So one day we went, now I can't remember where we went, but we're walking towards the Severn Bridge and it's something to do with the Blue Whale. But I can't remember for the life of me what the deal was behind it. Anyway, Michael took his drone. So Angela and I walked and Michael and Jonathan just stood playing like little kids with this drone. And me and Angela walked back to meet them. Then we went to the pub for a sandwich. Vera was in an element running around the garden. She got lost a few times. She caused, you know, every time the cockerel crowed or cock-a-doodle-dood or whatever they do, she went mad and what have you. And then we had, Michael had made sure the garden was safe, but he had like a stable, like a gate on his front garden. Half of it was, we put like fence, he put stuff up in front of it to stop her getting out. Heard some horses coming by. She ran off and she jumped through the only gap that was possible to get through, which had me hysterical because I thought, oh my God, if these bloody horses, because it was four of them, I said, these horses throw their riders off, I'm going to be in big trouble. Anyway, I went out. The horses were just looking at Vera with contempt as if to say, you stupid dog. There was Vera just sat there barking as if to say, whoa, this is a big dog. That was me. And I had to say to the horse riders, I said, I can only commend you because your horses are much more well behaved than my dog. Honestly, these horses were huge. Tall, bigger than me. God, bigger than me. Anyway, so so I got her in. I was a bit like, whew, I think I need a glass of wine, Michael, after that. Is it wine o'clock sometime in the world? And then the day we were leaving, we lost her. Well, there was four adults looking for her. And silently, we were all fairly hysterical as to say, my God, where's she gone? Because there was just so much flat country she could have got lost on and stuff like that. But she had a harness on. Her harness has got an Apple AirTag. So John could get a signal, which meant she was in the vicinity. We just couldn't find her. I was just about to lose the plot, you know, with the like snot crying and bubbles blowing out my nose and not pretty good, not like nice crying, that Angela opened the shed where Frieza was and Vera darted out as if to say, where have I been? In fact, I think if she could have said boo, she would have done. And we were like, whew. And then when I went back, Angela had made lovely bacon sandwiches for the lads. And now back, their dog was licking John's bacon sandwich. Honestly, I was like, there you go. Now, Michael, I have to say, if you ever watch this, had he been licking your sandwich, I would have let him. I wouldn't have said anything because it's your dog. Yeah, I would have done, really. So anyway, so we came back and then we were straight into Lucy's birthday. Lucy was 30. I can't believe I got a 30-year-old and a 32-year-old. God, doesn't seem possible. So yes, she, we said to her, can we buy you some, we'd like to buy you something you can keep. You know, I was like thinking jewellery, a necklace, stuff like that. She goes, oh great, a set of pans. So I was like, set of pans? What the hell do you want a set of pans for? And she said, I want a set of pans, a good set of pans with detachable handles. So we got her those. But I mean, it's been 28 years. And it's been 28 years since I bought pans because I remember buying my pans when I moved into my first house. And I suppose they were a lot of money then, but I've still got them 28 years later. So I suppose there can be something to keep. And what have you? But God, crikey, they've gone up in price, haven't they? We're like, not too bad. You know, I didn't spend silly amounts of money on them. But she's thrilled a bit with them. So, yeah, she got that. And what else did I get her? Well, she just got that. So she got some lovely stuff. She got some lovely, some beautiful diamond earrings off Phoebe and Thomas and Lydia. They all went together and bought these beautiful diamond earrings and what have you. And then that night, her and her boyfriend went off to Tenerife for a week. So I haven't seen her yet. I'll probably see her this weekend sometime, which would be lovely to catch up. Yes, yeah, so that's it. So right, I'm going to go now because it's 9:30 in the morning. I can't believe it. We came back from a caravan this morning and I was so organised that I was walking out the door to go to the post office to post some parcels. And when I looked at the clock, it was just 8:20. So I'm like, thinking, well, it's not even be open yet. So, so we're going to do that. I don't know where the dog's gone. Oh, she's back up in her basket. So nice chatting with you and listening to all my waffle. I'm sure there's loads more I could tell you, but you know, we can't be here forever. Oh, I've been here 30 minutes, which is just enough time, isn't it, for a cup of coffee and a biscuit. So I wish you well and take care, everybody. And hopefully, Jonathan might sort this out and get it organised. I'm just looking, my hair's a right mess, isn't it? But there you go. I love messy hair. I don't do tidy. So, right, bye.